Okay, everything is recording.
Okay, so I'm ready to start.
Yeah.
Okay. Welcome to the Astrolabe Maps meeting, okay? And I presented a number of Astrolabe programs over the years. This time I consolidated them all into one set of PowerPoints. I don't have to mix and match, so hopefully there won't be duplicates between any of them. Okay. So, there's the website of the college. Today is June the 1st. But I do astrolabes in Islam, although astrolabes predate the prophet probably by at least 1,000 years. Okay? But astrolabes are also used in Christianity after about the year 1000 because they're great clocks, particularly for calling people to vespers or prayers at nighttime. They can also be used early in the morning and late in the evening. They're not much good in the middle of the day because you don't know which side of the meridian the sun is on, right? At noontime, because when the sun is on the meridian, it's noontime, at least local apparent solar time. So, now, the astrolabe up there is a Persian astrolabe, right? And I have the real one here today, and it's pretty heavy. It weighs 14.7 pounds. And although the picture there doesn't show that it has a cotter pin that holds it, I will show you all the pieces. The top thing that's darker in color is the star map or the reet. Star map or the reet. Okay. Come on in. Okay. Well, maybe not. They're not coming. So anyway. So the stars are where some of the pointers are. Oops. Have a seat. Be comfortable. I will eventually want the Janus astrolabe. This one has both Arabic and Farsi on it. And I don't read Arabic or Farsi, but I have Arabic or Farsi translated. The Arabic is particularly hard for anybody to read because it's not written in the Arabic script that is common for most people to read, so you have to know an Arabic scholar who can read it. It's like trying to read German written in Frankfurter type, which is like Gothic steroids. Even if you can read German normally, you can't read Frankfurter unless you get all used to it. But I have such a person that did something last century when this came to me, when I authenticated. When I authenticated, this was not my first astrolabe. I'd already made one when I was a graduate student at LSU. And I had even given astrolabe talks and with Janus astrolabes and so on and so forth. And the Janus astrolabe stuff is at astrolabes.org. If you'll see there, you'll see that Jim Morrison died in April of 2016. So he's not making these anymore until I get my daughter or somebody else to take over the business no more. But you can actually go to another site and download and print your own for your, because what you really need is you need a reet or a star map, that's the top part, and a climate or a tympanium for your latitude. Right? Then you've got an astrolabe. Right? So a bit about how it's done. Okay. So here, people are still making astrolabes. Okay. This one's probably still around, although you can see it was made in the city of Aleppo, and Aleppo has been bombed almost out of existence in Syria. This is made, what is it, 2000? I believe, is when this particular astrolabe was made. And you can see it has a star map. Whoops. And it has a series of companions and plates. A matter which holds all things together. The throne is the top of the thing. And this one has 23 stars. And you can tell if it's a real astrolabe by measuring the star positions, the right ascension and declinations. And that would tell you that it is a real astrolabe. Here it is, close. Now, on the back of the astrolabe, they're highly variable. It has a rule, and on the back of this one, this can be good sines and cosines and tangents. So you can use it as a trigonometric. So that does civil engineering for you. Okay. It does all kinds of different things. So here's the reef on that astrolabe just by itself. Actually photographed last century while I had it for a month before I gave it back to the owner, which is Andy Wheeler, before he donated it to the college the last year. So it now belongs to the college. And you can take these things apart and put them back together. And they're pretty, the metal ones, and they're pretty robust. Well, they are made out of a semi-precious metal, and sometimes people would make weapons out of them when they melted them down. Mm-hmm. Right? Brass is expensive. So here is the matter of this astrolabe, and there is Quran, as you see, there is Arabic scripture on the underneath there.
Okay. When you say matter, is that a that's translation
generic
from
name for the thing okay. that holds the tympaniums, mm-hmm. the climates, and the root. And there's some pin that goes together, and generally a cotter pin or a screw. Philip said screw in the case of the one that I run around my neck, right? But this is like the one that Chaucer would have had, except for Phillips hadn't invented screws. It would have been a horseshoe cotter pin for the European type instrument. But the rest of the design here is similar to what appears in Chaucer's 1387 book, The Treatise of the Astrolabe, which is the first work in science education in a language that might be called English, or Middle English, written by Geoffrey Chaucer of Canterbury Tales fame. And there's a lot of astronomy in the Canterbury Tales. And it was written, the Treatise of the Astrolabe was written for little Lewis, who was 12 years old, and he's addressed as my son. Okay? So, by 1387, they were all over, they were European. But that didn't occur until about the year 1000. More about that coming up. So here's one of the tympanums of climates in this particular heavy 14.7 pound asteroid. The only real at the, here's the zenith, here's the North Pole. And so the angle here, because these are, that's the horizon zero, and it's marked off in different degrees, right? These circles around the zenith would tell you what latitude this astrolabe could be used at.
So these are the part that's specific.
Latitude specific.
Yeah.
And it'll work at any latitude. So Cairo, Jacksonville, Baton Rouge could all use the same tympanium. Because they're at the same, roughly the same latitude, right? Yep. But if you went to Edinburgh,
it's not
Paris, or here at latitude 41, you would need a different tympanum. Because that's 30 and a half. And here is tympanum 2. And here is tympanum 3. here is the dark use of the astrolabe, which wouldn't have been approved of in Islam or in Christianity, but people still had them anyway, right? And because Exodus or in Judaism, astrology was not an approved activity. It was the first Exodus where the astrologers are put in there with the whoremongers, the adulterers, and the murderers. Anyway, so, and that's, and this would allow you to find the horizons for a place that you're not, don't have a tympanium for. So if somebody comes and wants a horoscope, then you've got to know not only what day they were born, that would just get you the sun sign, but you've got another ascending and descending sign, and since the sun is, the earth is rotating, that's going to change, and the midheaven sign is going to change. So you need a horizon, so you can give them a full workup of their horoscope, all right? Okay, so here in the Scientific American article, the picture, I think, 67, are the plates or the tympaniums of the climates, which are latitude specific. Horizon coordinate system of altitude and azimuth, which are marked off on the reef or net. Okay? An off axis circle, which is the ecliptic. And the earth goes around there once a year for us modern fingers. For the ancient fingers, the sun went around the earth once a year. Either model works perfectly. Now mathematically, this thing is what's called conformally invariant. It preserves angles, but it does not preserve shapes. So what that means is you've got to know the sky good enough to know what star that is to line up with the right latitude, with the right altitude. Right? Because that's the part that you're going to set. And you're going to need at least two stars, providing you know which, where you are on the Earth, you've got the right tympanium in, right? And then, so that's latitude specific. And then you measure the altitude of two stars and set them right with these circles that come out from the zenith. Now, here's the stereographic projection. Since this is the northern hemisphere, you're projecting the south point, you're projecting the sphere onto a flat plate. And these things are portable. You couldn't carry a celestial sphere around engraved very easily, but this you could wear in a bag underneath your coat and travel. Now, these things were very valuable. Okay, when these things are being manufactured out of a brass, think of these took a skilled craftsman a couple of months to make. And think of the value of a Lexus maybe. And so you might want to hide that when you're moving through town in a bag because somebody might knock you in the head and take it away from you. We'll see more about this stereographic projection when we get to fermions, spin a half particle, same mathematics. There's a 4 pi or 720 degree symmetry hiding in this system. Good piece of mathematics gets multiple uses. Math is important. Okay. North Pole, equator, and tropics all projected onto your climate and how you do it. You get these. Traditionally, astrolabes ended at the Tropic of Cancer, except one that I'll show you later. I didn't know anything when I made my first one, so I don't know. Now, here's the ecliptic, right? Which is still 23.5 degrees with respect to the and on the modern astrolabe, I put the dates along the ecliptic, but most historical instruments would have had the signs of zodiac along the ecliptic. Now, here's a Janus astrolabe, pretty close to the current day. 18 years is not going to have much. Yours look more or less like that. You can see Lion, you can see Chardonnay, you can see. Oops. Okay, now that's 2000. Now, let's look at a series of plays from this book. And Janet, there's a 60-page booklet that came with the So the personal Astrolabe classical edition and all of these extra plates would have been in there, right? And other sorts of coordinate transformation plates in the classical version, because with the Astrolabe, you've got a book. And I'll mention there are some somewhat radical different Astrolabes. This is, I didn't even show this last time, because I forgot where I hid it. This is called an Astrolabe quadrant, and it's an astrolabe folded over four times, and it doesn't have any rotating pieces, but it does have a string and a bead and a way, and it can have a chrome. This is complicated. I have to think for about 5 minutes before I can use this. I don't have to think at all for the other type of the astrolabe. So this is a long time ago. So we see precession in 2800. And you can see the lines a lot closer to the final leaf marks. The big long line that are coming out. You can see the lines pretty far away from the warm vernal equinox now, at roughly five to six hours right ascension. Right? And this one has the signs of zodiac along, which would be typical. On a modern version, I had more respect some that had just dates along there. Then it was not so easy to cast horoscopes with it, since I didn't wish to. I encourage casting horoscopes with the thing we use in the collection. So, minus five. Time of Claudius Ptolemy. Now, we know these things were made in that time period because Hypatia, we have a letter that Synesius Syene wrote to Hypatia describing an astrolabe that he built after he went to the library in Alexandria and learned from her how to make one. He was quite proud of what she had taught him. And she was not the long In fact, this style of astrolabe that has the right ascension mark with the big long line was in fact the mother of the Hubble. I'm just giving this lecture to the Hubble Space Telescope a long time ago. Okay? And Nancy said, well, how can I measure right ascension from there? So we had to add for Nancy, the mother of the Hubble. By the way, there are Lego figures. You can get the Lego women of the Hubble. This, notice, this is in the far future when Vigo will be a decent North Star. It's not such a decent North Star. It gets overhead where I am in D.C. once a day, but anyway, it will be a decent North Star then. And look, Orion will then be outside of the tropics. So on most classical astrolabes made at this far future date, Orion will not be. But it would be shown on my astrolabe. So here's a plate, a complete plate. The crown, matter, Roman numeral showing, azimuth. So anything along here is north. Anything along here is south. While this is labeled east, this is really east. This is east, and this is west. I always wanted to get Morrison to move the word west. But so let's line up along this. And now this astrolabe and most of yours have a series of twilight arcs. This is the horizon, so when the sun gets here, it's sundown, I suppose. And then it has -6, -18, -12, and -18, which would have been twilight arcs. At minus six, it's civil twilight. You have to have the lights turned. Automobile, you can be given a ticket. It's beginning to get dark enough that you need the lights on the automobile. There's still, we have an atmosphere sufficient shine on the planet. It's minus 12, you can no longer read the binnacle on a compass, on a ship. So that's nautical twilight. It almost looks like the lights have been turned out when you're at sea. But you can still measure a little bit of light if your eyes or photometer are more sensitive than the human eye. So you can start, your photometer's up uncorrected when the sun gets to minus 18. Altitude projections. Lines of equal azimuth projected. And you can see the celestial sphere, black light, and later the pseudographic projection. These are hour angles. These are equal hour angles, or Babylonian hours, or sometimes called Italian hours, when you had 12 hours of daytime and 12 hours of nighttime. And that was important in some definitions of time. So here's a complete climb. Lines of equal azimuth, horizons, lines of equal altitude, canters, and hour angle lines, and the equator and the both tropics. But right in, oops, right in here, okay, right here. So that's, that would tell us what the latitude of this particular projection is for this companion, all right? Because the altitude of the North Pole tells you your latitude, all right? And Polaris right now would be near there, with about 4/10 of a degree. Not perfectly. Now, let's see how the climates change as we change the latitude, 25, 30, 35, 40, 45, 50. Now we're 55, 60. This is a coordinate transformation plate for 0 and 90. This is a plate for ecliptic transformations. So this is made for the Arctic Circle's latitude. Claudius Ptolemy was real interested in that, even though he'd never been in the Arctic and an Arctic Circle. He knew that they must exist anywhere. This is the dark use. This is a plate of the horizons for casting horoscopes. This is in 5-degree increments. This would allow you to get an horizon for ascendant and descendant, and the one in the middle would be mid-heaven for the reed. All right? So that's important for casting horoscopes and the dark use of the astronaut. Here's the back of that polygon. Most had a zodiacal calendar. Now, this one's real obvious to tell that the signs of zodiac and the dates do not have the same center, because the Earth's orbit is elliptical. And we're actually closest to the sun around January 4th, on average, give or take a day. And we're closest to January, and farthest away in July. And so these devices. Here's again, Astrolabe, the College Edition. The College Edition, you see that there are no signs of zodiac, but dates on it. Dates on it. And it's set for July the 25th, 10 p.m., the 10 o'clock, which is this is what I have. Thank you. modern version has the equation of time on the back. So my astrolabe measures local apparent solar time, or probably watch time or zone solar time. I take local apparent solar time, add an hour down by using daylight savings. And the Canoma Park is 8 minutes away from the center of the time zone. So then there's another 8 minutes, minus ET. And this is the ET peanut. And you see an ET rule on here. So you can get watch time. With an astrolabe of this size, you can easily get your watch time accurate to about 4 minutes, even if you're kind of casual. A little bit more accurate, maybe 2 minutes to set your watch if you're less casual. Astrolabe styles. There are four different styles of Islamic astrolabes as far as the decoration style. And this is Persian, and this is the Persian astrolabe here. Madrid, Andalusia, Spain. Spanish astrolabe. This is the University of Bologna. Moorish astrolabe. So this is the kind of astrolabe that, so that, there's some references to Islamic astronomy, Muslim astronomers. This fellow wrote a book called A Thousand Uses of the Astrolabe. But exaggerated, his book only has 386 chapters. The chapters are short, pages. They each give a particular problem or thing you can solve with the astrolabe. This is a marvelous device. Right. Now, in this time period, nobody in the Christian West would have had one. Here's the guy that brought it to the Christian West. He goes into Moorish Spain, when his name is Gilbert of Arillac. He later becomes Pope Sebastian II. He was actually a great mathematician. And actually a pretty decent pope. He didn't have any girlfriends. And he more or less followed the gospel. In the power struggle of being pope, since he was a mathematician, they did accuse him, his enemies that were not faithful did accuse him of witchcraft. Okay. This is the first astrolabe that I met. See, now I put the dates around the outside. This is, you know, this doesn't have a corners. This doesn't have the reading on it. And there's some paper red. You can see where the hole is. About 30 degrees, 30 and a half. Right, this latitude of Baton Rouge. But I was dissatisfied with this because my hand's not that steady. So the physics and astronomy department had a draftsman, and she made a really good one. Again, this is atypical of astrolabes because it has the entire celestial sphere at this latitude projected down onto it. Because they were shining light. Canopus that were pretty far south and wouldn't have been on a normal astrolabe. Because only the stuff within shows both the stars and the and again I put the dates along the side of the zodiac. Not the 13 signs of zodiac, including if you just snake him. Here's Fred Willis. He's put the star map on the bottom and rotating the climate. Here's There's the electric Astrolabe, which you can download and run on any Wintel chain. Go to astrolabe.org and click on the right link. And this puts the planets along the ecliptic. And this has been used by history departments to tell where planets and moons and all those kind of things are always going to be near the ecliptic. And it's highly accurate. Made by Jim Morris. He's a vice president of IBM Corporation. That's why it's a Wintel machine. He actually wrote it in machine code. It's really, really incredible. But anyway, he's. You can see this is the daytime. You can see the sun up there in the lighted region. So, sun, and generally 12:38 p.m. Daytime. And it also has other things that give you data. This is a linear astrolabe designed to use in a spacecraft from by the Grumman Corporation. On that page, New York, and a student gave this to me because it didn't mean much to him. It belonged to his father or grandfather. Okay, now I want to, and this has two polar patches as well as the Mercator projection. Now I'm going to read you why this thing was really made. It is pretty grim. On the back, Astrolabe, Astro Guide, as an emergency navigator. The Astrolabe in low Earth orbit may find it necessary in emergency to use navigation tools and aids of those provided as capsule. For example, assume that his capsule has been successfully injected into some orbit, not necessarily the one for which the launch vehicle was programmed. It might even be assumed that a near polar orbit has been achieved. Conceivably, it could become the astronaut's task to determine his position above the obscuring Earth with no aid being furnished by ground controllers with a sidereal clock and astro guide. He can locate his position over the Earth at any time during the flight. Because it's been a nuclear war. And many people on the ground are dead. And he has to decide where to fire his retros, the landing, someplace, hopefully over land, where he can recover himself. Compliments of Grumman Aircraft Engineering Corporation, Beth Page. And this is on the back of this instrument. Okay, I'm still out of my seat when I saw this. That's an astrolabe projection. Same projection, same stereographic projection. Now what is this physics book called? Physics of spinners, fermions, spin a half particles, quarks, electrons, muons, taus, not photons. Just to remind us, it was the astrolabe. And now back to the, this is figure 1.1 in the book. Same mathematics projection for astrolabes and spinners. Here's the equations. Now I wrote astrolabe on here in the book. Relation between rotation, three-dimensional physical space and rotations in space of spinners. Okay. This is the book that invented spinners. It was the Dover publication, translated from French into English. It's not an easy read. Spinners were actually invented by Eli Carton before physicists knew about spinners. You can download this book in English. Theory of Spinners by Eli Carton, Topics of Spinners, Dirac, Minkowski, Riemann, and Special Relativity. Because later on, he wrote more about this subject. Because he was really more, he was not only an abstract mathematician, but a mathematical physicist, major proportion. The Mobius strip is in here, which also has 4-pi symmetry. The Mobius transform has a built-in piece. Moshe Kermelian, Jamon Malin, in the Theory of Spinners also mentions this sort of thing. And for that matter, so does Penrose in The Road to Reality. I'm almost finished. Are there any questions? About Astrolabe. If you want any of these slides or any of the other ones where I only use some of them, you're free to use them. Just say that you got some of them from me on at least one of the slides, but then change them for your audience, please. Because, you know, it depends on who your audience is, whether they're going to know what spinners are and fermions or care one way or the other. Everybody should care about fermions eventually. Made of it. It's interesting stuff. The astrolabe is not principally a navigation device, it's a time device. Although you can use it for navigation in a pinch, and there is a one that the Huguenots had that fell into the water in the St. John's River near where I grew up that was recovered that was more of a navigation instrument. Now, the Mariner's astrolabe is a navigation device, and the Portuguese made lots of those. When the Huguenots were slaughtered by Menendez in Fort Caroline, that's when that one went into the water. It's an interesting device. It has both a past and a present. Used for all kinds of different things. And every culture, since it was invented, has wanted to use it in some way. If you believe in the story of the wise men visiting the Christ child, they would have probably had one of these on their neck because the astrolabe was already 300 or 400 years old at that time.
The companions for the different.
Yes, they would have had a couple of companions.
Were these, when you have a variety of these, 5-degree increments?
You could have it 5-degree.
Well, you could do it anyone, but.
Anywhere as long as you're on the hemisphere.
Right.
You would have to replace the reed if you went on the other side of the equator.
Yeah.
But as long as you're on the northern hemisphere. Of Chaldee in that area is the northern hemisphere. And so is frankincense and myrrh. Gold's found why. As an aside, frankincense has interesting medicinal medical problems. Right? We'll talk to Rupert more about that.
I'm cured.
And I joke, it's good enough for Jesus, it's good enough for you too. I have used frankincense on my foot to get rid of the little fungus. Okay. Also, if you get the right grade stuff, it actually freshens your breath. If you eat myrrh, you have to be more careful with. Right? Use it in wine, also give you diarrhea, take too much. But you can burn both of them, right? And it's with sweet smelling incense and pretty valuable.
Just a note for medicinal purposes, you don't want the perfume, you want the therapeutic grade.
Anyway, because of the oil that it's that the stuff is dissolved in by distillation does make a difference. I have a student assistant in Haiti whose family, Leger, produces some of the best oil in the world from perennial plants. Holds the soil in southern Haiti down, keeps it from being washed into the ocean. His grandfather formed the company, his great great grandfather, as a Wikipedia article, right? And knew Frederick Douglass and was a very influential person in Haiti. So his family has been, and he's training to be a chemical engineer so he can continue in the family business. approved his timesheet a couple of days ago, even though he's now in Haiti. But then I want to approve it again until he gets back in the States until August, late August. So at community colleges like I teach in Montgomery College, we have all kinds of interesting people. Every sort of person you can imagine from all over the world. Rich and poor, smart and not so smart. But it's our job to make all of them smart and clever. And, you know, with enough time invested, even a person with a shaky hand like mine, you see those circles I couldn't draw so well, right? Who was always picked last on all those sports teams for a good reason. I would have picked me last, too. Right? And do all kinds of interesting things. You know, we don't have to be here any longer. It's 11:44 right now.
One of them fuel the asteroid?
Yeah, why don't you turn on the light so you can see your asteroid. Play with your asteroid. If you have any questions at all, just ask. Bring up the light, would you?
Yeah.
So they can actually see their instrument, even make it brighter if you want to. In fact, you need a lot of light to see these marks. So you're looking at the backs. No, you're not. You're looking at the fronts. Oh, you're looking at a primo astrolabe, because you can see I've added a lot of things to this with a colored marker. So you have a really excellent one. Okay.
Wait.
Well, that would be the, you can, this is, see, you could use this to measure, see, there's the right ascension, zero, mm-hmm. 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, four hours. So these are the right ascensions from this, right? And these are actually times mm-hmm. when the sun on the ecliptic would hit one of these things. So it's here, it's noontime, here it's 6 p.m., here it's 6 a.m. Here it's midnight, right, when whatever the sun is down here, right? And you can see the way the seasons change just by looking at the ecliptic and when the sun is going to be, you can see only on the equinoxes is it actually going to rise in the east and set in the west real easily. So there are lots of neat things you can see with playing with your astrolabe. 1920s, Gunther wrote a book about how astrolabes are better than watches in some way, because little boys could take them apart and probably put them back together and they probably would break, or watches. A little boy takes it apart and probably won't work again.
I'm going to pick up the Wheeler.
What?
The Wheeler astrolabe.
Oh, okay. So the Wheeler astrolabe again, which is way heavy. All right. Now, we know it was made about 500 years ago. What we don't know is how it got to Mumbai. So its provenance is only appears when it was brought in, but it is a real astrolabe. It's not really a perfect instrument. Let me tell you of a criticism. Notice when I rotate this, it wants to rotate the climate. Okay. If I were making this astrolabe, I would make sure that this thing stayed fixed here and didn't move when I rotate. Typically, you'd put a little... You have to put a little notch here and a little notch thing that would fit into it. Then you wouldn't have that problem, right? So this astrolabe may have been more of a presentation or show device that you could put on your wall to impress your clients about how knowledgeable you were.
You really didn't know how to use it.
You know, and you could use it, but it would be a little bit of a pain, right? And as you can see, it's Montgomery College property now because Andrew Wheeler donated to the college. He also had other navigation devices. He was a submariner before he went to the community college. And then he went to the University of Maryland, became an engineer, finished it up there, and then rose up in the ranks of Vector Corporation. Now he's older than me and retired. I'm 67 and still in the workforce and not on any prescription medication at the moment. get paid for having fun. The only thing that I do that I don't consider fun is grade as an adjunct professor. I'm in two labor unions, same employer. So I'm also a professional troublemaker. I only make trouble for people that make trouble for students or employees that haven't done too much wrong. But I am a steward in AFSCME. As a staff person, as planetarium director and physics lab coordinator, I'm paid adequately. As an adjunct professor, if any of you have ever taught as adjuncts, you know, you're only paid peanuts. It's not fair. It's a disgrace. Mm-hmm. It didn't used to be that way when I was a. Right now, even at Harvard, half the professors are adjuncts. Mm-hmm. And communities and universities all over, half the people are adjuncts, and they're not compensated fairly. And that's something that will need to change as a social justice thing. So for that, I'm a member of SEIU Local 500. And I was the organizing committee. I'm also a member of AFSCME. I was the organizing committee of that, the staff. But I'm not a member of AAUP, because that's what the full-time faculty members are members of. Yeah, rather than. Okay. So let's put these things away. We can turn things off. And I'm going to crack. I need to get my peanut. That's stupid. I've got to cut a... Okay. Yeah, put them in the... Rupert, get the box. Drop them in that box. There's a box over there.